Tourette syndrome affects 1 in 100 people in the UK. That's the same prevalence as celiac disease and epilepsy. It's hard trying to communicate this to you with all this noise going on. It's kind of funny, maybe, but it's not really. Imagine if this was going on and on every time you tried to talk to anyone. Hold on. How was that for you? Could you focus on what I was saying, or were you concentrating on my cactus friend? Was it annoying? A bit awkward? Funny? Distracting? For me, that noise started when I was 3 years old. I remember it clearly. I was sat at my child's table and chair set in the living room. That red plastic table and chairs we all had. My mum brought me my favourite tea. It was the most iconic meal of the 90s. Waffles, three fingers and baked beans. And as she came close to the table, I got this rush of excitement and slammed my hand down. I didn't think about doing it. I felt like my stomach made me do it. This, back then, was brushed under the table as a nothing. Three-year-old kid being a bit strange, bit of a shock, and that was it. Further episodes happened. I began clearing my throat and rapid blinking at odd times. My mum suggested to my dad and her friends that I had Tourette syndrome. I was taken to the GP, and the response was, hopefully he'll grow out of it. It's likely behavioural. Children often do strange things. I didn't grow out of it. I'm Jason, and I have Tourette syndrome. I am the 1 in 100. Myself and the other 680,000 individuals living with Tourette's in the UK. The key feature of Tourette's is tics, which are involuntary movements and or sounds. And usually, prior to these tics occurring, I will have an urge called a premonitory sensation. And the tic is to satisfy that feeling. It's a build-up of agitation in my core, a bit like the feeling right before you sneeze, but much stronger. There are huge stigmas surrounding Tourette syndrome. Everyone with Tourette swears, you heard of that one? In fact, less than 20% of us swear. And the actual term for this is coprolalia. People with Tourette's are putting it on, another one. Tourette syndrome is a complex neurological condition. On top of this, there are many co-occurring conditions associated with Tourette syndrome, including anxiety, OCD, ADHD, and autism. Something that can take you 5 seconds to do could take someone with Tourette's 10 minutes. Tourette's can be extremely painful. My Tourette's was extremely painful. As well as the physical pains, I suffered from shame and isolation. In primary school, the tics were easier to cover up. Eye rolls, throat clearing, sniffing, etc. But this was just like stuffing that cactus inside my jacket. It was still making all that noise and I could feel it jiggling about. I knew something wasn't quite right. No one else was carrying an annoying metaphorical cactus around with them. I began to realise that excitement, especially happiness, made my tics worse. Joy meant agony. So my coping mechanism was to be and remain melancholy, especially when I should be having fun. Imagine playing games with your friends in the playground and mentally trying to remove the fun. I remember sitting at the top of the stairs at home, leaning through the banister, listening to my mum and her friends talking in the kitchen. Okay, I was eavesdropping when we should have been in bed, but we all did it. And I often heard them talking about me. They would say things like, he's not going to find work, have friends, have a relationship, or kids. And despite my mum defending me with positivity to her friends, I heard them and I started to believe them. When I hit puberty, my condition was put on a turbocharge. Within the first week of high school, despite every effort to cover up my tics and suppress them where I could, other pupils noticed and began laughing at me. And when they laughed at me, I became agitated and the tics became even worse. I had never felt so embarrassed and misplaced in all my life. In the crowded school corridors, I'd never felt so alone. I began missing school. I just couldn't handle it. And at this point, I still didn't have a formal diagnosis, so there was no doctor's note to cover all the absences. My mum decided to pull me out of high school altogether. Because of my condition, I missed out on my high school education. The fun and friendships too. Just after my 13th birthday, and 10 years after that first episode at my red plastic table, I finally received my formal diagnosis of Tourette syndrome. And with a diagnosis came the possibilities of treatment. I was offered medication as a way to help manage a condition. The banding of medication are known as antipsychotic and anti-seizure medication. But I wasn't psychotic and I'd never had a seizure. Nevertheless, I tried dozens of them, from haloperidol to paracetam to olanzapine. These are powerful medicines, and sometimes the side effects can be worse than the condition. I suffered really badly with restless legs, attention problems, moodiness and zombification. I was willing to try anything just to be able to walk to the shops and not get stared at, laughed at, or receive verbal abuse like, what kind of drugs have you been on, mate? I felt alone and completely reliant upon myself to cope and find ways forward. Even each encounter with the health system felt very experimental. And I found myself in a position where each time I visited a healthcare professional, I was having to educate them. At 17, like a lot of us, I received my provisional driving license and my first lesson was booked in. I did warn the instructor of my condition and over the phone he said he was willing to give it a go. I left my house, walked the 5 seconds up the drive to the parked silver Toyota Corolla where Ian, the instructor, was waiting. I saw the look on his face change from an empathetic look to extreme fear. I was nervous, so severely ticking as I got myself into the driver's seat, I put my belt on, and as if by magic, my tics just stopped. For the first time ever, they were gone. The cactus was quiet. I was free. My lesson finished, and I left the car on a high. But as soon as I got out of the car again, I started ticking like nothing had happened. And as confusing and as stressful as all this was, it gave me a glimmer of hope and I wanted more. At 19, my condition reached its peak. I started having tic attacks which tended to last from 15 minutes to many hours of constant intense movements. I tore muscles, then I had to twitch those muscles even more. Imagine being bitten by a mosquito, and the only way to satisfy the itchiness is to scratch. Feels better at first, but then the itchiness comes back stronger, and you have to scratch it again. Before you know it, you are constantly scratching your skin. Now, imagine doing this for many hours. And now, imagine not being able to stop, no matter how hard you try. My most prominent tic was in my neck, and I was at risk of seriously damaging my spine. Learning to drive had given me hope. I just knew that my life had to be better than it was at that moment. So I started researching cures for Tourette's on Google. I was willing to do what it took and take any risk. So I did the unthinkable. I went on to page 2 of my Google search results. Practically the dark web. And it was there that I found a medical journal talking about the discovery of deep brain stimulation and the potential benefits on movement-related conditions. A few points stuck out to me. It was discovered and developed in the late 80s in France. It was initially given to patients with tremors and Parkinson's disease. It comprised of making holes in the brain, inserting electrodes that would emit an electrical current to suppress involuntary movements. And finally, I couldn't find any details on success, just a lot of pointers on risks. So I booked an appointment at my GP and was referred to the experts who listed me for surgery. There were no guarantees and lots of risks, but I was ecstatic and, of course, ticking more than I ever had done. But this time, the tics didn't bother me. This was it. On the day of the surgery, I decided to get the bus to hospital. 2 buses, in fact. I wanted people to see me in this uncomfortable, agitated and frustrated situation I was in. I wanted people to say goodbye to this version of me as a final bit of closure. And now I want to say goodbye to this version of me as well. Have you ever tried to put a cannula in a person with Tourette syndrome? It's not easy. It took 2 nurses to pin my arm down as a 3rd tried to put the cannula in. That day, I became one of the first people in the UK to have deep brain stimulation for Tourette syndrome. The deep brain stimulation lead and the surgeon came to speak to me after the surgery. They said I may have something called the stun effect. It's a period of time, usually around 2 weeks, where I won't have any symptoms of Tourette syndrome. And I realised that I hadn't ticked at all since I woke up, and I had none of the premonitory sensation either. For the first time ever, I could speak to someone without 1,000 interruptions from the annoying cactus. I could think I want to get up and go to the bathroom. And guess what? I did, just like that. And things that would take me 5 to 10 minutes now took seconds. The annoying cactus had been switched off. After 12 days of the life I had wanted, the cactus came back to life. My tics were returning. It was like winning the lottery, then being told my ticket was for a previous draw. A month after the surgery was the appointment to program the device. This was scary. I was sat on a chair while someone with a computer on the other side of the room was controlling my brain. The first setting, nothing happened. The next setting, I felt dizzy, saw flashing lights, and felt like I was going to pass out. We tried multiple settings. Some made me feel unsafe and not part of this reality, disorientated and generally wanting to scream out of fear. And some did nothing. But then we got it right. My tics were almost entirely suppressed. On the bus ride home, I wasn't distracted. The cactus wasn't making all that noise and I wasn't doing anything to hide it. I started noticing things that I hadn't been able to notice before, like the amazing patterns on the bus seat covers and the smells on the bus, which I knew was a mixture of dampness and cannabis, but I loved it. And on the walk from the bus stop back home, the bricks on the houses seemed incredible. I was experiencing everything for the first time again. The cactus had the batteries removed. I took a risk having my surgery. Remember, I let someone put holes in my brain. I let someone else with a computer control my brain. But the risk paid off. Now, without my tics constantly disrupting every moment of my life, I have defied my mother's friends. I now have an incredible partner, 3 wonderful children, an amazing career, and great friends. And in case you're wondering, I did pass my driving test. My doctor took this video of me prior to deep brain stimulation.
Yes. Yeah. And give me a feel for how much it kind of affects you in day-to-day life.
I'd say socially, relationship-wise, a lot, because you don't want other people to deal with it the same as you do, so it stops you having any relationship or anything like that.
Huge contrast. Not just in the follicle department. I am Jason. I am still the 1 in 100 people in the UK who has Tourette syndrome. If we remove the shame and embarrassment around this condition and make the struggles and pain more visible, I believe this could open more doors to research and maybe more breakthroughs in medicine and innovative procedures like deep brain stimulation. Maybe then, more people like me wouldn't be existing with Tourette's, but living with it. Thank you.